afternoon, good morning, and good evening. So, let's start with today's session and let's see what exactly we are doing. So guys, yesterday we spoke about build. We spoke about continuous integration. We spoke about different type of triggers. What is branch filter? What is path filter? How do we schedule a build? How do we do a build completion and things like that. Now the next part was to do a release. Now we have to hold the release for now. The reason is to hold because there are small topics in between which we need to cover. What are those small topics? The small topics are to understand what is service connection. That is the small topic is. The second is we need to understand in order to understand service connection, you need to understand what is service principle. And in order to understand service principle, you need to understand what is Azure AD in simple words. Okay. So Azure AD, it's Active Directory, we all know. The user management, group management, all this is done at the AD level, at the Azure AD level. Give me one quick minute, I'm getting a call right now. Okay, sorry guys. So I was talking about Azure Active Directory. So your logging to cloud, your access management, group management, the RBAC, all this is managed by Azure AD. Okay, AD is nothing but it's a Active Directory. So let me show it with a diagram that will make more sense. So imagine this is your AD. Not AD, this is your Azure cloud. Okay, give me one quick minute, let me get this. Give me one minute, I'm getting the call again. Okay, sorry for that. Okay, this is your Azure Active Directory. It's your Azure cloud. Inside your Azure cloud, you will find out your Azure AD over here. Azure AD, that's Azure Active Directory. So what are the various ways you can connect to Azure cloud services? What are the authentication and authorization methods you can follow? The first and the easiest one what we follow is the user ID and the password. We create a user and the user will have a user ID and the password and so forth. So similarly, we'll have multiple users created in Azure AD. Okay, so the user will be created on Azure AD. The passwords will be generated and based on your role and your profile, the accesses will be given. You'll be authorized to use n number of resources. Like you, if you are the administrator, you will have all the accesses and you can do whatever you want on Azure cloud. But if you have been given only tester access, so you will have limited access, just limited to your profile. So authentication is where you put in your user ID and password. And you're getting authenticated at the Azure AD level that this is a genuine user. This user can log in. Now, if you see this, I'm currently, let me close this incognito and open it over here. If I go to portal.azure.com, because the credentials are auto saved, it logged me directly to my account. Now, how exactly this has happened? This is because this user, DevOps Mela, this is already a user and have the right privileges to log in to Azure cloud. Now that is authentication. Now this user, what all things this user can do? Now if you go and look into Azure AD, so I am a global administrator right now. So basically, I am the owner of this account, so I can do anything. So I have all the privileges. So if you want to verify, you can just simply go to Azure AD. You go to users and you will find my DevOps Mela member. If you go inside it, you find more details. For now, let me delete this test user. Okay, if you want to know more about this user, you can see DevOps Mela is the member, and there's a role assigned to this person. What is the role? You can go and look into the role. Global Administrator. So on my Azure AD, I am the Global Administrator. I can manage everything. I can even assign roles to others. Okay, so that kind of role I have it over here. So the whole purpose of saying all this is because there are one way is the traditional way of creating a user and assigning the passwords, and post that user can access the resources on clouds. Like suppose you have your subscription over here. You will have your subscription over here, and through this subscription you can connect to resources such as your VM. It could be your SQL server, your web server, your storage account, all this, whatever you can name it. So consider this as your VM. Okay, so these are your resources. Consider this as your AKS cluster. Then what will happen once you get authenticated? You are at somewhere over the cloud. From the internet, you're trying to access. Okay. So what you will do, the first thing will happen, you try to log into your cloud, then it will get authenticated using your user ID and credential. Then Azure AD will check what kind of access privileges do you have. Okay, if you have privileges to access this subscription, then it will go allow access to this subscription. Then once you get access to this subscription, you will be able to access your resources. Okay, there are different fund of resource group and all, we are not talking about that for now. So on high level, this is how you will be able to access your resources through an authentication and authorization method. Okay, so this is one example. You create a typical user and then you give the right privileges. So that is where role-based access control comes in. So you can control the access using RPAC. So what is role-based? Basically, it is talking about just give that those accesses which is required for doing the right job. If you are the tester, you need to have only tester-related access. You should not get administrator access. If you are a developer, you should get developer-related access. So we should follow least privilege access policy. You should, if you want, give less access, don't give more accesses. That is what least privilege is talking about. Okay. Later, if you want, let the user go and request for access and then give him the access. But upfront, don't give any additional accesses. That is what least privilege access control is all about. Okay. One way we saw creating a user and things like that. Now this is if you're trying to connect to internet. Now what if you're trying to connect from any third party application? In my case, it is Azure DevOps. Correct? This is a third party app, though it belongs to Microsoft, but If you talk about this, then it's a third party app, correct? You're trying to connect again from internet. This is Azure DevOps is a different portal altogether. It's hosted on cloud, it's on internet, and now you want to connect to your services. Now there is a Azure web app, like there is a VM, so you want to connect to your services. So how does this communication happens? Same way, I can make use of user ID and password, and through which I can go and connect to the subscription with all the required privileges. with all the required privileges, you can connect to the subscription, then you will be able to connect to the VM, or if you want to connect to AKS. The only difference is you're not doing it by yourself. This is happening through a pipeline. Now, how this connection gets established? So there is a, if you want to set up something like this, you need to have a service connection created. What do you need to do? You need to have a service connection created between these two applications. Which are the applications? The application is Azure Cloud and Azure DevOps. These are two different application which is hosted on cloud, and if you want to establish any connection communication between them, then you need to follow a service connection route. Okay, now the issue over here is you need to have a user ID and password created. You need to manage that user ID and password. You need to make sure that the password is rotated on time if you're creating a typical user. Plus, this is a dummy user which you're creating. It's a service ID. We always create a service ID which is kind of a dummy user. The whole purpose of the dummy user is just to have such connections created. So no user is actually using it. It's just created for some such purpose. That is what service ID concept is all about. Now, what if tomorrow if the password is expired and no one knows it? Then your connection is break in between. So you need to make sure, what if the password is given to someone else by mistakenly? What if the person who knows the password has left the company? Now you need to make sure you remember to go and change it. So this is a baggage which comes with if you have a user ID and password like concept. What if there is a third party application which you're creating a custom application and you want to have some resources which is there in cloud and you want to access some resources using your application? Again, the same thing, you'll have to fit in the user ID and password in your custom application. So you're hard coding. So we are doing a security breach, correct? This is not what is recommended. You cannot put in hard code any user ID password anywhere. How do we secure this now? So user ID password is a way out to create a service connection. I'm not denying on that. You can do it. But the better way, what Microsoft recommends, is service principle. What is a better way, what Microsoft recommends, is service principle. So this is a different method, guys. Service principle. So service principle is basically is the same concept wherein your user ID and password works. What is the concept? Authentication and authorization. The only difference service principle has, it will not have any user ID and password. In place of user ID and password, it will have client ID and client secret. Okay. Now, this is what Microsoft suggests. Now, this is again the authentication method. This is basically used mainly for such types. This is mainly used for such types. Give you an example of Azure DevOps. Second example is if there is a custom application and if you want to access any resources, then so this is for you, for such types you will be using service principle. You'll not be using for logging to your portal, like the way I've logged into your portal. You'll not be using this service principle concept, guys. This is basically used for if you want to connect to any third-party applications, you want to connect to any other portals to your cloud services, then this is how you will be connecting. What is the benefit of using service principle? Firstly, this is recommended by Microsoft. If you have any such requirement wherein you need to connect to any third party application, then use service principle. That is what Microsoft recommends. And Microsoft is not even stopping you to use user ID and password, guys. You can still use it. I will show both the methods of creating service connection. I'll show you using user ID password also. I'll show you using service principle. So whichever you like, you can go with. But I have given you the pros and cons. What is the pros of using service principle? What will the cons of using user ID password? So benefit of using service principle is you don't need to manage any passwords. You can have temporary base client secrets created, which will get eventually expired. And if you want, you can just recreate it. You can have a recreation done automatically if you want. So all this, plus you don't need to have a headache of maintaining and managing any user ID over here. So service principle is also a concept for authentication and authorization, which is done by Azure Active Directory. In most cases, whenever there's a two service which is communicating, even within the cloud, okay? Like suppose you have a AKS cluster and you have your image in ACR. Now you want to create a pod. So what AKS will do? AKS will go and connect to ACR, fetch the image, then it will create a pod, correct? How the communication will happen within that services? Again, a service principle will be created within those services. You need to create a service principle to authenticate that the image pull request is coming from the right source. Again, a service principle. So just an example. So communication between two services within the cloud also will be authenticated and authorized using service principle. Okay, so even over here you need to create a service connection. So this is how you need to go and create service principle first on Azure Cloud. Create a client ID and client secret. Now what exactly is service connection? If you want to connect to two resources like Azure DevOps and Azure Cloud, you will be connecting using a service connection. This is how the authentication and authorization will happen, and then your pipeline will be able to execute the task. So the build which we have created, if you want to deploy that build on Azure Cloud, the first thing is you need to create a service connection. Okay, so the first way is we'll go and see using the service principle method. This is the recommended method. So we'll create a service connection using service principle method. The second is we'll use it using a user ID and password. So we'll see both the ways. Whichever way you like, you can go for it. Okay, any questions with this theory, guys?
So the connection must it be within Microsoft, or it could be with any other outside Microsoft?
So Azure DevOps, this is example of Azure DevOps. If you have any other services on any other application, like you're connecting to GitHub, to your cloud directly, again, all this authentication will happen using service principle method only. That is the recommended. So when I say recommended, this is what Microsoft is saying. If you want to use any other way, you are free to do it. There are other ways also to connect to cloud services. And if you think user ID and password is more relevant and it is serving my purpose, then you are free to use the user ID and password also. Microsoft is not stopping you. So that's why I show you connection creation using user ID and password also. Both the ways we'll see it today. Okay? Make sense?
Yes, it does.
Okay, any other question before we start with the demo, guys? Any confusion, any question? What is service principle, what is AD and things like that? No? Okay, so this was the build pipeline what we have created. Now in order to deploy this, we need to have a service connection created. In order to create a service connection, you have to go into project settings. There's an option of under pipeline, there's an option of service connection. So service connection helps you to manage, protect and reuse authentication to external services. Azure Cloud is an external services for Azure DevOps. Okay, so in order to connect to it, you will have to create a service connection. Now if you click on create service connection, see this, how many third-party apps you can connect to. If you want to connect to Terraform, you want to connect to Azure Cloud, you want to connect to Bitbucket, Cargo, Chef, Docker Hub, Docker Registry, whatever you want to connect to. And if you don't see anything available over here, there are plugins which you can download. And once you download the plugin, even that will be available over here. Okay. So now we are connecting to Azure Cloud. So in this, there are Azure Classic and Azure Resource Manager. If you remember, at the very beginning, I gave you the difference between Classic and ARM. Classic is the older way of managing resources on cloud. ARM is the newer way. So we'll be using Azure Resource Manager. When you select that and you hit next, there are two ways: Service Principal Automatic, Service Principal Manual. So we'll stick with manual for now. When you click on manual, what are the things it is asking for? It is asking for subscription ID, subscription name. This is very easy. You can get it from your subscription. The ID and name, when you go to your subscription, this is your ID and this is the name. You get this information. Now the important part over here is service principal ID. So now we have to go and get this thing created. Service principal ID. Second, it is asking for service principal key. So these are the two things which we need to create. Third is tenant ID. You get the tenant ID easily with your subscription itself. Then you can verify this. Okay, let's close this. Come back and let's create the service principal first. Okay, open Azure Active Directory. Okay, under Azure Active Directory, if you come down, there is a under manage, there's an option of app registration. App registration is basically, this is the place wherein you will be creating service principal. So one of my secret got expired. So I'll just delete this. Let's delete this also. These are all old. Not necessary, you have to delete it. I'm just deleting it. Okay. So you need to click on new registration. Give it a name. So I'll just name it some familiar name, DevSecOps-1. Supported account type. You are creating this service principal for single tenant, multi-tenant, or for what purpose? So this is a single organization, and this is a single tenant account which I'm using right now. If you have multiple organization, then you may have multi-tenant, but in my case it is single tenant. I'll stick with single tenant. Redirect URI, just ignore it, because this is more if you're creating a custom application. You can have your, like, if the person gets authenticated successfully, then what page to, what will be the landing page. So that this is what it is asking over here. So this is not my requirement. The only requirement is I just need to create a service principal. That's it. Register. I have this service principal created. Now the service, before you go and start creating service connection, this is created. You will have your client ID and client secret created, but this service principal needs to be authenticated at the subscription level, and this person needs to be authorized. Like, you are creating a service principal, that means you are authenticated at the Azure AD level. You have your client ID and client secret, that means you are authenticated at Azure AD level. But are you authorized to use any services? That is the second question. You're authenticated. You have your service principal created. You have your client ID and client secret. You have given this information to others. But are you authorized? So the authorization needs to be given. What does that mean? The authorization. You need to go and add this service principal at your subscription level. Why exactly are we adding at the subscription level? Because through this subscription only your resources are getting created. Understand this. Through this subscription only your resources are created. If you're authenticated over here, sorry, you're authorized over here, then you can probably access this resources also. That's a different story that you can, using RBAC, you can have more control at the resource group level also. That's a different story. For now, if you are authorized to use this subscription, that means you can access this VMs also. Okay, keep this in mind. So I have my just created service principle, and now let's go at my subscription level. Now I just open my subscription. Under access control, this is where you will be assigning role-based accesses, guys. Under access control, there is an option of role assignments. Let me delete this unwanted roles. Okay, so under role assignments, you can go and click add role assignments. Okay, now there are multiple roles. There are predefined roles which is there. Okay, and if you don't find anything which is predefined, and if you want to have a custom role created for your purpose, then even that is possible. You can go and create a custom role for yourself. But overall, there are three types of role which you can at high level. A owner role. A owner is a person who can have full access to manage all resources, including the ability to assign roles in Azure RBAC. So owner has full access, plus he has ability that he can assign roles to others. So the global administrator account which you saw, I have owner access. If you go and see in my subscription, let's go back. Do you see I am what? I am the owner. So the authentication was done at the Azure AD level that I was the global administrator. I can manage Azure AD also. Now authorization to use resources is done through subscription. Keep this in mind, guys. So I am the owner. I can do whatever I want. Now same goes with your authentication was done using your service principle at Azure AD level. Now if you leave this thing as it is, and if you go and create a service connection, your service connection will fail. Because why exactly are you creating a service connection? That so that you can access the resources. That is the main purpose, correct? You don't want to access Azure AD, you want to access the resources. So you need to have authentication done and authorization done at the subscription level also. You need to give this service principle the right privileges to access the resources. That is what we are doing right now. Come back. Let's go and add assignments. So owner, we know. Contributor will have full access to manage all resources, but it does not allow assigning roles in Azure RBAC. He can manage, he will have full access to your resources, but he cannot assign roles. A contributor cannot assign roles. Keep that in mind. A reader, by the name itself, you know, it will have read-only access to all your services. So for this, because I'm assigning role to my service principal, so I'll have to give a contributor access, because I don't want this service principal to assign roles to someone else. Just to access the resources and manage the resources, I'm creating a service principal. So contributor role, user group or service principal. So what is the name of the service principal? DevSecOps, correct? DevSecOps. This is my service principal. Is visible now. Select, next, review and assign. So what did we do? Created a service principal at the subscription level, given the access. Now secondly, I can now go and create my service connection. ARM, I'll keep it manual. It is asking for subscription ID. Let's go in overview of subscription. This is your subscription ID. Copy this. Put it over here. Subscription name. This is the name. Put it over here. Service principal ID. For getting the service principal ID, go back to your Azure AD. Come to your apps. This is your service principal. What what it want principal ID. The principal ID is nothing but your client ID. This one. This is for authentication. And how it will be authenticating? There are two types. Either have a service principal key created, or you can have a certificate created, whichever you like. Okay, how do you generate this? This can be generated in certificates and secret. Inside your service principal, there's an option of certificates and secrets. Click over here. Now, what you want to create? Whether you want to create a certificate or whether you want to create a secret. So let's stick with secret for now. I create a secret. Name, whatever name you want to give. And expiry, you can select the expiry 90, 365, 455. If you want some custom expiry, you can do that also. Let me create a minimum. Now this is your secret ID and secret value. So this is what we want. Okay, copied this, putting this over here. What is the tenant ID? For tenant ID, go back to your overview. And do you see the directory ID over here? This is your tenant ID. Copy this, put it over here. Now verify. If you get a verification succeeded, that means all your authentication and authorization is in place, and you can now create a service connection for yourself. Now you can name it whatever name you want to give to your service connection. I'll stick with the same name, DevSecOps. Now it is asking whether you want to grant access permission to all your pipelines. I can just click over here, verify and save. Done. If you click over here, if you click on manage service connection roles, it will basically take you to the subscription role assignment page. And if you click on manage service principal, it will take you to this page. Now this is done. Now if I want to create a pipeline, and if I want to deploy my packages, I can easily do it with this service connection. I will have no issues right now. Okay. So if you want to create a pipeline, now release pipeline, and want to deploy or build the package which we created yesterday to deploy it on cloud, then easily you can do it. Make sense? Any questions? Anyone? Any doubt? Any question? Okay. No questions. So this is this method.
Yeah, Rohit, yeah. Rohit, one question here. We seen the creation of service principal, right? In place of the same service service principals along with we created service connection also, right? It's a mandatory to create service connection also. When we are creating service principal?
No, it's not mandatory. So my whole purpose was to create service principal is to eventually create a service connection. So my target was to connect my Azure DevOps with my cloud. Okay. Mm-hmm. So service connection is basically a bridge between your Azure DevOps and Azure cloud. A bridge gets created. Using the bridge, you will be authenticated and authorized to use resources on cloud. Okay. Why do you want to access the resources? So suppose you have created a build, there's a package, now you want to deploy that package on Azure VM. How do you do it? And that is something you need to do it through pipelines. That's in an automated manner, not a manual way. So this can be eventually done using a pipeline. Now your pipeline needs to be authenticated and authorized. How that authentication and authorization will be given to your pipeline? Using this service connection. Okay, in tomorrow's session, don't worry, we'll create a pipeline and I'll show you how this service connection will help us deploy our application on Azure. Okay, now this is one way. This is the way which we have followed. Now I said like even user ID and password can be used to create service connection. This is second way, user ID, password. Now in my case, frankly guys, I can directly click on new service connection, and if I use this automatic method, then automatically my service connection will be created. How? This is because if you see my email ID, even my DevOps account, I'm using this email ID, devopsmail@gmail.com. And if you see this email ID, this is both same. And this person is a global admin. So if I just use the automatic method, it will go and create automatically. But this is not what I want to achieve. Imagine if there is a different email ID. Your Azure DevOps, let's switch to a different email ID. There's an email ID called mailadevops@gmail. It's a different email ID. Now this person needs to be connected to my cloud. This cloud, which is managed by this guy. How will you give him the access? How this guy will be able to create a service connection? Okay, this is a different email ID. Now in this case, if I try to create a service connection using this or using this method, it will not let me create. Now what all things you need to do? Firstly, I need to add this user into my Azure AD. This user is not there, correct? We all know. We don't have this user in my account. I don't have this user in this account. Okay, the first step is, so I'll let me write this down because this is lengthy. What is the use case, guys? Again repeating, let me go in the notes. So this notes, I'm maintaining this notes on the drive also, guys. So use cases: service connection creation using user ID. Okay, so the first is add user to the AD. Okay, how do we add new user? There are two types of user you can create: a new user, or you can create an invite external user. So I want a domain name @gmail.com. So if you want that domain, so new user will not work. You have to go with invite external user, because if you use new user, then it will give you on microsoft.com, something like this, it will be given. So this will be an internal user to your Azure AD. So I'll stick with invite external user. Doesn't matter, guys, whether you create an internal or external, it doesn't matter. Now what is the name of this user? Name whatever name you want to give. Mailadevops. What is the email ID? Mailadevops@gmail, correct? If you want to give a first name, last name, give it. Any message, any group you want to add it, you can do it. For now, I'll just click on invite. Okay, so this is, we have created a user and we have sent a request to the user that to go and accept the invite. So if I log in, hopefully I should log in with have to open an incognito mode if I want to log into that account. Gmail. mailadevops@gmail.com. So what this person has to do? Hopefully I remember the password. What this person has to do? This person has to go and open this invitation, go and accept this invitation. What is the second step? Accept the invite by Microsoft. Okay, second step done. Again, password. This is what we are doing. We are taking the different route now to create a service connection. Okay, so this is done. Let's close this. What is the next step? Now this person has been added. Now the invitation has been accepted. Now can this person log into my cloud services? If you ask me, the answer is no. Now you will say why? Because I have not given any authentication privilege, like what exactly this guy will do in my Azure. Now if you want to have an authentication privilege given, you can select and you can assign roles to this person. What type of roles you want to give? Depending why you are adding this user. Why exactly did you add the user? You can go and assign roles. This is I'm giving authentication on my Azure ED. Keep this in mind, guys. I'm not even touching the subscription. I'm just talking about this part right now. Only this part. So in this part, you need to give authentication privileges. You have to give roles like what exactly this user is, what capability this user will have, and things like that. So you can have multiple roles. For now, I'm giving him a global admin, because I want to eventually create a service connection, and service connection you need such privileges. Okay, so I'm giving a global admin. What this person can do? Manage all aspect of Azure AD and Microsoft services, that user AD identities. So I'm adding this. So this is what assign roles to the user at AD level. Third step, fourth step. Now this person, Mela DevOps, if he wants to log into this account of mine, to this, he can go and use his email ID and its own password, and he can log into my account. He can be authenticated at the AD level. Now can this person access my subscription and access my resources which is there inside the subscription? The answer is no. Why? Because this person is not yet authorized to use any services. You will say, we have given global admin. Yeah, that is at the AD level. Now this person is not authorized. Now in order to authorize this person, you need to go and give him access at the subscription level, the RBAC access. Okay, now give assign access at subscription level. Fourth step. Okay. Now go back. Go back to your this. Go to access control again. Go to role assignments. This is the two role which we have assigned. Now go and assign this role to this user also. Now again, similar what we did with service connection, I'll giving contributor access. The name of the person is Mela DevOps. It is visible now. Now create a service connection. Done. Now can we go and create a service connection? Let's see if we are able to do it or not. So I have my other account open. So let's open it over here itself. dev.mela.devops. Okay, so this is my account. I'll close this over here. Okay, let's go to your project. Project settings. Permission, not permission. Service connection. Let's create a first service connection. I can do it from here. It will go try to do things automatically, or else I can do it at the pipeline level also. Both the ways, let me show you the pipeline level. That is more, that is the place where you will get stuck. That is the reason, because if you're doing it for the very first time, and when you're trying to deploy something, like suppose you create a release pipeline and you try to deploy something on Azure App Services. The first thing it will ask you for a subscription. Now when you see at the drop down, now this is visible DevOps Miller training. Why? Just because this ID is authenticated and authorized on your Azure AD now. That is the reason this subscription of yours is visible. DevOps Miller training, this is this account subscription, correct guys? Hopefully no one is confused. DevOps Miller training is this account subscription. This is because you have done the prerequisite. These are the prerequisites. If any of this step is missing, you will not see this drop down. Keep this in mind. If you miss on any of these steps, you'll not see this drop down. Okay. Now, if you want to create a service connection, click over here. It will ask you for authorization. Let's click on authorize. It will ask you for your email ID and password. Just put in your email ID and password. And let's put the password. Then I have given my user ID and password. Let's see if my service connection is getting created. Perfect. I am getting an error. Service connection creation operation failed. The error is failed to set Azure permission role assignment. So your role assignment, there is something related to permission issue which I am getting right now. So that means the contributor access which you have given, that doesn't, it is not working for this user. What I can do, remove it and let me change the contributor access. This is again a disadvantage of using user ID password, guys. Let me change it to owner. Why owner? I'll tell you later. For now, let me do it owner. Let me give this guy a owner privilege. Done. This guy is owner now. Come back. Authorize again. Why exactly owner? I know you guys have question. I'll talk about that in a bit. Just give me 1 minute. Let's see if we are getting the error now. So basically this is creating a service connection automatically in the backdrop. So let's wait. Okay, this is taking a good amount of time. Let's wait, refresh, authorization. When this authorization is successful, there will be a service connection got created. How do you verify? Go to project settings, leave this. Go to your service connection. You see this now? Now if you click over here, and do you see there's something called manage service principle, and there's something called service connection. If you click over here, where are we? On which page are we? We are on a service principle page. Even though you're using the user ID password route, it has created eventually a service principle from you, and it has created a service connection using this route only. Though you're using user ID and password, it has created service principle in the backdrop. Hence, when you have given the user the contributor access, the contributor cannot assign roles. the contributor cannot assign roles. So when a contributor cannot assign roles, he cannot add permission at the subscription level. Now let me refresh this and show you what exactly was happened automatically. If you go and see the role assignments, do you see this Mela Dev, Dev Sekov? There is a contributor role assigned automatically. Did we assign this? No, this was assigned automatically. Hence, this person needed owner access. That's why we don't use user ID and password for creating any service connection or service principle, because you need to have owner privileges, and no company, no administrator will give you this privilege. If you want in real time, if you want to create a service connection, you will reach out to your administrator. He will create a service principle, he will create a client ID and client secret, and he will give it to you. That's it. Now just imagine, if you want to create a service connection using user ID and password, what kind of privileges you want. That's why even I've given global admin privilege over there, because only the owner is the right person to give access to someone. And now using this user ID and password, when you were creating a service connection, it was automatically creating a service principle, it was automatically creating a client ID and client secret, and it was automatically adding you to the subscription. This was all which has happened in the backdrop automatically. The things which we did manually, this using this method, this was done automatically. Understood? Why owner privileges? Okay guys, so this is all about your service principle, service connection. Whatever route you take, user ID, password, whatever route you take, eventually it will create a service principle for you and it will help you. There's one more method, I don't know if you guys have noticed it. There's one more method to create a service principle was manage identity. This method. Manage identity is also nothing, guys. This is basically using service principle. When you go through manage identity route, it will be creating a service principle. The only difference is, now many of you will say that we are still exposing, even with service principle, we are still exposing the client secret, correct? The client secret is something we are copy pasting from here and there. So it's kind of a exposing which you're doing. That can be easily used using a certificate, you can use it. But yeah, again, if you want more security, more secure connection, then you can use manage identity. Manage identity, where you will not have any secrets and everything. This will be automatically managed at the Azure level itself. Now, if you go through the manage identity option, see, there's no option to put in your secret, certificate, nothing as such. So it's altogether a different method. The passwords, the certificates, the secrets, everything is managed by Azure internally. You don't have access to it. So if you're taking this manage identity route, so if you get any question, highly secure, if there is any interviewer who is giving you back questions that the client secret is not secure, you're copy pasting it, then what to do? The next is manage identity. In manage identity, being an admin, you will not even have the client ID and client secret. Forget about others. Okay, so that's it from the service connection and this Azure AD's concept of authentication and authorization and RBAC. Let me know if you have any question. Make sure to practice. This is there in my assignments. In the service connection column, there is this assignment is there. Make sure to complete this assignment, because this will come very handy when you start working on Azure DevOps, when you start connecting your Azure DevOps with third-party applications. Azure Cloud is a third-party application. Don't consider this as a Microsoft application. Think of it's two different applications, and you want to establish a bridge between this application. Why do you need a bridge? For the traffic to go here and there and to access the resources. So for that, you need to have a service connection created. Are we good? Anyone has any question, please do let me know. Anything in the chat? Nothing in the chat. Okay. Anyone? I'll have the steps added again onto my drive for your access. Okay. If anyone has any question, please do let me know. Tomorrow, we'll start with continuous delivery and deployment. And we'll be deploying using classic method. So we will be basically deploying our build pipeline which we have created to Azure cloud. So we'll be deploying things on Azure web app. So that is something we'll do it tomorrow using classic method. Okay, anyone, any questions? If yes, please do let me know, or I can wind up the call for today. No questions, guys? Okay, perfect. Make sure to practice. Hopefully I should get questions after you guys practice. And anyone is practicing, like whatever we did till now, are you guys up to speed with me, or anyone lagging behind, or they have not done anything yet, just going through the lectures? Anyone over here? Ivanu, Kishore, Bhagya, are you guys are practicing? Ragul?
Yeah, Rohit, I'm doing. I'm not good, no problem.
Perfect. What about Sebastian, Saurav?
Yeah, I'm fine. I'm fine. Everything is good.
Great.
So I'm also practicing with VNets now, creating security group. Because I'm joined the team
you
late.
You have
right?
joined late. Yeah. It's totally accepted. Yeah. No problem. Take your time and let me know if there's any doubt. You can reach out in the group, or you can reach out to me. Okay. No problem.
Okay, sure. Thanks.
Baba Tunde?
No, not really. I'm still lacking behind. I need to do some cash.
Just make sure, and if there's any doubt, do let us know.
Yeah,
we can have a doubt solving session if required.
Yeah, like the one I told you, I'm still not able to see that on my what's it called, my Visual Studio. I uninstall it, restore it again. I still don't see the ESP.NET. Yeah, on my computer.
No, that's not a. So that what I can do, I can share my application which I've created. You can open that application directly, because that should not be a roadblocker for you if you're not able to see the plugin. I'll share this application in the drive itself today. You just go and click on this solution, and you will open my solution, and you can work on this solution. Okay.
Okay. All right.
Because the application creation, any which ways, that is not our roles and responsibility. That is something a developer needs to do. Now, your roles and responsibility is to set up the build and release pipeline on top of it. That is important. Okay, so Bhagya, how things are going?
My build pipeline getting fail. I got one error.
Do you want to share it?
Oh yeah.
Okay, let's see what failure is. I'm just stopping the recording for now.